Hello, Australia. Welcome to episode 682 of The Couch. We have got a big show coming your way today. Talking music with Demelza Leonard, talking music scene with Slim Jim. He's back in the studio today. We'll be talking to him. What's on Perth with Belinda Cipriano. She's back. We're doing an amazing dinner that's coming up. We're actually promoting it. It's called the Big Outdoor Picnic Dinner Event. We'll tell you more about that, and we'll also try and pronounce it in French as well. Gary Mitchell, you know him from Sweet and Sour. He's also the cousin of Basil Semplis. He's running for the City of Perth election as a councillor. We'll talk to him today. Now, Annie Chandler Cummings is an amazing author. She's written 3 books. We're going to talk to her today. And Fresh and Local with Sandra Bubba. She's with Nisha today, talking Middle Eastern food. Music-wise, we've got a bit of opera with Paul O'Neill. So stick around. It is a big couch. Episode 682 starts now.
It's showtime on the couch. Hey, it's showtime on the couch. You can see it from your house. You can see it from your house. It's showtime on the couch with Fred and the best in town. You can see it from your house. Yeah, it's showtime on the couch. Oh, oh.
Hello, Australia. Welcome to another edition of Your Local Couch, made in Perth for the whole of Australia. Hello to everybody in New South Wales and Victoria and everywhere else in Australia. I hope things are looking a little bit better. They are in Victoria, which is nice to see, and maybe soon you'll be able to visit us here in Perth. What am I saying? Our Premier would never let anyone come and visit us. But welcome anyway. Time to talk music first with Demelza Leonard. What did I say this? There's no way our Premier would open those
borders. I think we've still got a while.
We'll be the only state, I reckon, Demelza, that won't be able to go on holidays.
I agree.
Unless you want to go to Western Australia.
Exactly.
What's happening in music? Because you've got a lot of stuff happening.
Yeah, there's been some big news. Now, Mariah Carey has a new memoir that's coming out called The Meaning of Mariah Carey. And in this, she's dropped a bit of a bombshell. Mm-hmm. So in 1995, when she recorded the iconic Daydream album, she was also sneaking into a studio with one of her friends, Clarissa, who is part of the band Chick, and writing a rock album. This is the track Demented here.
Don't mind this.
Mariah lends some vocals to this, but she also wrote a lot of the album as well. So it's a very whole, no doubt type of sound, like that female rock sound that came out.
Why has she gone this way? Elvis, it's not about money.
No, well, she had, when she created this particular album, it was her way of freeing herself from the marriage that she had with Sony record producer Tommy Mottola. And this was her way of kind of trying to let go and not be so controlled by everything. Of course, she's announced now that she has created this album. What we didn't know was she's been dropping Easter eggs about this for quite so many decades now as well. There's butterflies in Chick's video clips. She has a song on one of her more recent albums called I'm That Chick. So she's been telling us for a long time. We just didn't know. And now that fans do know, there's a very strong chance that that album's going
to
be released.
I have to say, since the Packer lifestyle, when she was with, was it James Packer?
James Packer, yeah.
For a while, and The Ring and all that sort of sidetracked me from her music. But I'm glad she's back on board again and doing music, good music as well. So good luck to her.
Yeah, so there's a lot of stuff, and this book has been, it's going to be very interesting to see how it goes for her and shed a lot of light on things that we thought was what was going on, but it was all a bit smoke and mirrors.
Wait and see. Now, another wonderful singer, Whitney Houston. What's happening with her?
So the late Whitney Houston, Scott Storch, who's a well-known producer, had a live stream with a number of performers. Now, Whitney actually had a hologram that was part of this particular concert where her hologram, along with a few other artists who are now deceased, were interviewing and presenting live artists that were performing. Now, Whitney's hologram originally was meant to make an appearance in 2016 for a duet with Christina Aguilera for The Voice, and that got canned by Whitney's family and her estate, saying that they felt that the hologram didn't look like Whitney Houston, therefore they weren't giving permission. The creators of the hologram have been working on this particular event and have gone ahead without the family's permission. So now her family and estate are looking at if they have actually grounds for legal action.
Suing somebody.
Exactly.
Isn't it terrible that there's more legal lawsuits when someone passes away?
Yeah, and also America is such a litigious society as well. So that's exactly it. And exactly. Speaking of lawsuits.
Well, Kelly Clarkson.
She has one coming her way. So she's being sued by her longtime management, Starstruck Management Group, over alleged unpaid commissions.
So, this is her TV show
that she had. Now, the suit alleges that she is in breach of an oral contract, that she owes $1.4 million in commissions for the work done on the Kelly Clarkson show, as well as the work that she did when she was on The Voice as well. Now, this is just up to today's date. They believe that by the end of the year, she could actually be they could actually be asking for $5.7 million in unpaid commissions.
That's a lot of money. Not that it'll be a lot to her, in the sense that she makes a lot of that probably in a couple of minutes.
That's exactly it.
It's still a lot for someone like us.
Well, that's it. And, you know, when you're looking, that's the unpaid commission. So there was obviously some sort of agreement if they think that they've got a bit of a case.
Do you think that because they do have a lot of money, they don't really pay attention to what's going on, or is it they're just not into the legal side of things
and doing things properly? We look at these big named artists and they've got a lot of people doing stuff with them. I mean, we just have to look at what Ellen DeGeneres is going through at the moment, and the fact that she doesn't know or claims to not know.
So,
you know, the fact is that other people could be doing these things and she might have
she might be oblivious to it all. They leave it to somebody else.
Exactly.
Top three for this week?
Yes, let's have a look. Top three.
These are, hopefully they've changed. I hope you can tell they've changed.
Oh, well, this one's coming. Former Geordie Shore star Joel Corey and MNEK with Head and Heart.
Don't mind that one.
At number two, 24 Golden with Mood. And at number one, still holding it down, Cardi B and Megan Thee Stallion with Wipe.
I don't mind that one. It looks all right.
I don't mind it. I wouldn't go too hard listening to the lyrics, though.
Okay, fair enough. Good advice. Demel Zaletta, just sticking around. You're talking to Slim Jim very soon
as well.
We have got some music coming up on the couch now. With all the music scene sort of opening up again here in WA and hopefully around Australia, Paul O'Neill came in last year. He's an amazing opera voice. He's going back into doing shows. He's waiting to be allowed to leave WA and do stuff over east and overseas. But he's with us today. Thank you very much for coming in, Paul. Here he is performing Centre Stage.
La donna è mobile, qual in piuma il vento, muso all'argento. Sempre un amabile leggiadro viso, in pianto, in riso, menzognero. La donna è mobile, quel piuma e vento, muta l'accento e di pensiere. E di pensiere. È sempre misero chi li s'affida, chi le confida, mal colto il cuore, pur mai non sentesi felici appieno, in su quel seno non viva amore. La donna è mobile, qual piuma e vento, muta l'accento e di pensiere. E di pensiere.
Thank you. Thank you very much to Paul O'Neill. Always a beautiful, beautiful voice. And he'll be back later in the show, unless I go overtime, Paul. Hopefully you can stick around. We're going to be talking music again. Back to Demelza. Slim Jim's back. Welcome back to the couch.
Great to see you again, Fred.
And how are you doing?
I'm feeling much better. Thank
you
very much.
You're looking good?
I'm feeling good. Still, I think I've got a few more weeks before I'm in true recovery mode, but feeling a lot better
and everybody
than
out
what
there
I was through going through treatment anyway.
I think everybody out there would be excited to see that you're doing well, you're kicking on and moving back. Music scene is opening up again and you're
slowly
back in the business.
Surely. You know, it's not really still COVID-19 friendly yet when it comes to, I think it's 2 square metres per person still when it comes
hard
to the phase four regulations. And obviously we're screaming for the phase five to come into play, if not for the sake of reopening borders, which you mentioned before. I would dearly love to see it get down to 1 square metre per person when it comes to licensed premises. So, you know, if there are 500 square metres in a venue, then 500 people can actually occupy that space, which would be fantastic.
Fantastic. Demelza, I'll throw over to you. You guys can continue the chat.
Yes. Welcome, Slim Jim.
It's great to meet you, Demelza. Thank
Lovely
you
to meet you too. Now tell us about We Will Rock You, because that is a big one that is Perth-based.
It certainly is. You know, it's actually nearly sold 20,000 tickets now for the season
fantastic
that starts on Friday the 30th of October right through to Sunday the 22nd of November. Casey Donovan is the star of the show as Killer Queen, so she's going to be coming over and going into mandatory quarantine.
I was going to ask, is she going
rehearsals
to be doing the quarantine?
Absolutely has to. But she's also complemented with a team of local artists that have had a great amount of experience working on the production in previous years, and that's Blake Williams, formerly of Mix 94.5,
yes,
and of the local band Proof, who's playing Galileo. Holly Denton, who is the daughter of Dean Denton from The Frames, the
yes
very famous 80s band in Western Australia. They were actually quite famous across Australia for their massive pulling power as a live band. And Holly does an outstanding job as Scaramouche. Paula Perore and Clay Darius, the
yes
Evita
yes
couplet from The Voice from a few years ago. Paul is playing Oz, Clay Darius is playing Brit. Dean Misdale, who's one of Western Australia's most recognised drag queens as Feminine. He's playing Khashoggi this time round. Matt Dzinski from Mix 94.5's Breakfast Show is playing Buddy, and he and I are both sharing the role of Buddy through the run. And we're looking forward to it. Now, for those that haven't seen We Were Rocking before, it features 24 classic Queen songs and a fantastically funny script by Ben Elton, who actually is also locally,
is
a local entity now
yes
as well. And tickets are selling very fast, as I mentioned before, nearly 20,000 in the period of time since it's opened, and they are available from Ticketmaster. And I strongly suggest, if you want a great night out of entertainment, that's a great show to come and
see. Well, what a great thing. You've got local Perth talent paired up with an iconic soundtrack from Queen.
Absolutely.
So you
and
can't
the songs
go wrong
are iconic. Like, I mean, there's people will walk away singing their favourite Queen songs of all time. And I went and saw them recently at Optus Stadium and they were just brilliant. You know, so if you saw the live concert, come and see the stage show, you're going to get a good taste of Queen classics. But the script is so funny. It's so entertaining.
Wonderful. Support local. Now, speaking of local, we've got a bit of an event gig guide
sure
of some of the things that are happening in and around town. So I believe Renegade has a show coming
yeah
up.
Yeah, now Renegade are WA's most popular country rock show band. They are an outstanding act. If you remember back to days in the 80s and 90s with bands like the Magnificent Seven, these guys have certainly kept that sort of momentum going with their style of show. It's more than just what you expect. For example, they'll take versions of AC/DC songs and then countrify them.
Right.
So, you know, so country-fried rock and roll, so to speak. But they've got a great show coming up at the Stirling Arms in Guildford. It's a wonderful live venue on Friday the 16th of October. Tickets are only $10 per pre-sale and $15 at the door. And the ticket pre-sales are available through Try Booking. I strongly suggest you go down and see this. It's something a bit unusual. And if you like that sort of country rock crossover from everything from the Eagles right through to this countrified rock stuff, you'll love this band.
Fabulous.
And also coming up at the Stirling Arms mm-hmm pretty soon afterwards, also in October, is 80s Underground. They're WA's foremost 80s specialist. They're an outstanding band featuring Ian Falk from bands like Tora Tora and Dr. Bogus in years gone past. But Ian's a fantastic frontman, one of the greatest frontmen to come out of this state, I would believe. And they're playing at the Stirling Arms, as I mentioned, on Saturday the 31st of October. Tickets are available from the venue.
Yes.
But so I strongly suggest you you get down and see them, because if you love the 80s music, which I know Fred does, Fred's an 80s freak from way back, you'll love this
band. ABBA!
I was waiting for it.
Yeah, I was waiting for that too.
So tell us a little bit, Mod Squad have a couple of events.
Now, Mod Squad are also the same team as 80s Underground, but they're celebrating their 10th anniversary this year, which is fantastic.
Yeah.
And they've had a very long and stellar career. They'll be performing at the Woodvale Reception Centre on Friday the 20th of November, and tickets will be available online next week. Every time these guys play, it sells out. So if you don't get online in the next week or so, you will miss out. So I strongly suggest you check that out. But congratulations to Mod Squad also. 10 years of doing anything in this town. It's something to, you know, to crow about, that's for sure.
Definitely a fantastic anniversary to be celebrating. Now, Darren Reed and the Soul City Groove, they are doing something the Mindari Festival,
and that's a family event too.
Yes.
So, Demels, I mean, we all need these family events to take our kids to sort of introduce them to live music. And Darren and his wonderful team will be performing at the Boat, the Mindari Festival, which is up in Mindari on Sunday the 29th of November. The show's between 3 and 6pm, and prior to 3 o'clock, they're going to be proudly supported by Clayton Bolger, who's also one of Western Australia's premier soloists. And I did mention this is a family event. It's an outstanding location there on the marina. So if you've got nothing to do on that day, I would strongly go up and sort of celebrate everything to do with the Mindari Festival.
Fantastic. And quickly before we go, I believe you and the Fats will be performing your first gig as well.
Yes. So after we finish We Will Rock You, the Fats will be kicking off again their live shows at the Woodvale Tavern, which is one of our favourite haunts, on the 27th of November, Friday the 27th of November. Great news about that, Demelza, is that it's free entry.
Wonderful. Excellent. Go down and support all of these fantastic local bands.
Absolutely.
Slim Jim, thank you so much talking live music with us today. Fred, it is back to you.
Thank you very much. Slim, before you go, we've put up your website there with a Facebook page, but I wanted to ask you, any news on Telethon? Do we know what's happening? Are they going to have music this year?
Well, they are, and I did, and here's a bit of a hot story. Yep. Casey Donovan and the ensemble, or the main cast and ensemble from We Were Rocky, will be opening Telethon.
Fantastic.
And I believe they will also be closing Telethon.
And that will be at Burswood at the Crown Theatre, isn't it?
And that's the correlation. Fantastic. That's the reason being.
And one more thing. 1927, the band, whatever happened to them? Because I know the guy's a Perth guy. Are they still here in Perth or are they gone?
Now, Eric's still in Perth, the lead singer. And he's just been appearing recently in a couple of corporate shows, which has been fantastic for him. Yep. And his voice is still absolutely tip-top notch. So
love to see a few of our old bands. Can I just say thank you to the RSC Arena as well? They've brought back bands, musicians,
I was there last week, Fred.
They are wonderful.
I was there last week and I saw Murphy Brothers, and they were sensational.
You need a lot of venues around Perth. While you don't have other shows, bring in music acts, bring in musicians, make it cheaper, make a bit of money to cover your costs, but make sure that we showcase all the people that are out there.
Because the talent here in Western Australia, Fred, is really high standard.
Yeah, I agree.
Totally agree.
Well done, Slim Jim, coming back again. Hopefully, maybe we'll get you back on our last show for the year.
That'd be awesome.
November the 1st, if you've got time.
Look forward to it.
Demelza, a couple of weeks' time, we'll see you again.
Definitely.
And we'll see you at the other side of the break. We're talking about an amazing event that's coming up. It's a dinner, which is all white. Lots of food, and Belinda Cipriano is telling us where else to go. See you after the break. Nah. Welcome back to The Couch. It's always a pleasure to have this lady in the studio. Her name is Belinda Cipriano, journalist, presenter, author, cook.
Oh, a little bit of everything.
Dress designer, dress fashion, photographer, sitting on the beach in Broome. Welcome back.
Take it all. Thank you very much.
Did you have a good time flying?
I had a wonderful time.
Did you fly Qantas or Virgin?
I flew Virgin.
It's not your fault.
No, I know. It's not my fault. Normally, I'm a Qantas girl. I am a Qantas girl.
Did you have a good time in Broome for all those people that haven't been? Give us
a couple of seconds
of why you should go to Broome if you haven't.
Why you should go to Broome? Because you instantly feel relaxed. Like I was saying to you, revitalised and refreshed. I'm ready to take on the rest of the year, so fantastic. Bring it on. It's fantastic.
It is nice to know that lots of events are coming back to Perth and also around Australia. But we're talking about what's open and what's on in Perth.
Correct.
Let's go through them, Belinda. And can I just say a quick plug for your book as well?
Oh, thank you.
What's the book called?
It is called Constance and Madeline's Seaside Adventure. I've only got literally 10 left.
Oh, forget about it then.
No,
you're not going to print any more if 1,000 people want them?
I'm going to print some more.
Can you buy online editions?
You certainly can at my website, so www.belindacipriano.com.
We'll give it to you at the end as well, her website. Please support her. Wonderful book. This is your second book?
No, this is my very first debut book.
Oh, I can't guarantee it's a great read. Because it is our first, but
it's
I can tell you now, it'll be a fun story and a wonderful story.
It is.
Now, Wine Machine in the Swan Valley, what's happening with that?
Yeah, so October 17. Now, this is the first of the musical events happening here in Perth.
Mm.
So, obviously, we've not been able to with COVID, but Wine Machine in the Swan Valley is happening at the Oakover Grounds, obviously in the Swan Valley, and it is $79. Is it 79?
I'll tell you what, it's actually 89. This is like higher. It's like the new price is right. Higher. 89. It's $89 for general admission and $139 for VIP, like you and me.
Yeah,
but
exactly.
We should get that complimentary.
Exactly.
You and me be who
wink,
we are.
Wink, yeah.
The lineup includes Hot Dub, Time Machine, the Jungle Giants, and the Young Francos.
Franco, yeah, and more. Now, do you know about Hot Dub, Wine Machine?
No, I didn't even know there was a Young Franco and an Old Franco.
Okay, so Hot Dub is a DJ. Now, he basically does, I've never seen him live, but I have heard him on the radio, and he does sets between the decades up until today. So that's what he's doing. There's food, there's wine. So if you want to head along,
in
89.
The valley,
I know,
beautiful.
Right?
If you're here on holidays and you can't escape because of our borders, go down to it's just a matter. Swan Valley
machine
is beautiful.
Yeah.
More information at wine-machine.com.
Tickets are going to sell out for this, so get in quick.
$89 for general admission, $139 for VIP.
That's right.
Books.
At the bar. See?
At the bar.
Again, another theme. There we go. Books at the
now
bar.
Now, this is returning on Wednesday, October 21st.
Correct.
With Rebecca Raisin, who is celebrating, folks, her latest release. It's called Aria's Travelling Bookshop.
That's right. So this follows on from Rosie's Travelling Tea Shop. Now, Rebecca is a local author. I actually am hosting this one, and this one's
I was going to say there's a Belinda Cipriano
that's a
journalist and children's book author. Surprise, surprise.
So I know, I'm hosting this one.
How did we not link that to you?
I love working with Beck and supporting local authors, as you know. And so this is at Innaloo's
Tassels Bar.
Yep.
At the Bistro in Innaloo. Doors open at 5:30 p.m. Thank God you give me all this information.
Well, and
you
it's
don't have to say this.
I know, it's $9 and you get your nibbles and you listen to a Q&A between me and Beck.
Funnily,
so
she
that'd
got
be
that
fun.
Right. Trybooking.com is where you get your tickets.
Tickets and trust me,
nibbles.
They'll sell out. And it's a good event. She's a great author. If you like chick lit, definitely get Beck's books.
You know what? Support everybody. Even if you don't like it, just do something
different. Yeah, support local. She's a great local author, so definitely one to look out for.
Now, Pixar Park is at the RAC Arena, isn't it?
Correct.
We had
at the Plaza out there. This one's a good one for the family. Mm. Take your family out. These feature, it's a putting ground, so you can play 9 holes or 18 holes. It's $19.90 and they feature themes like
The Incredibles
and Finding Nemo.
Monsters, Inc.
Open
daily tickets start from $19.90 and can be bought at tickettech.com.au.
And definitely book ahead because these sessions book out quite
especially
quickly.
Especially school holidays.
Exactly.
And
this is on until October 25.
Now, why does it surprise me that Perth Racing is on there? I know you love race
day. I do love getting out to the track, that is for sure. So this one is for Derby Day on October 31. So
you say Derby, do you?
It is
not
Derby
Derby
Day. Well, Derby is more of
Derby
the footy.
Derby sounds footy, doesn't
Derby,
it?
Derby, Derby with the footy. Derby Day is all about racing. So
October
this is
31st, by the way, at 9:30 a.m. it starts.
I don't know who heads there for 9:30 a.m, but anyway, doors open 9:30 a.m. There are cocktail events that are held and VIP events, but I like to go general admission, and it's $16, and you can buy your food, your drinks there, and sit and watch your race. There's also DJs, music, all sorts of things
what
happening.
What a wonderful event, especially getting us back into the horse racing.
We're very lucky because Melbourne is not going to see these sorts of races.
And celebrated style an exclusive cocktail event at the Trackside Club.
Yep.
In the air-conditioned marquee. It's perfect for me. Plenty of food, perfect for me again. Beverages, packages and DJ entertainment.
Now, definitely.
Can we also say general admission was, you said,
$16. $16.
Tickets, www.perthracing.org.au. Check out their calendar. The best of WA. Let's not forget this one.
Yeah, the best of WA. So the team from Kathmandu Kids are looking after this, and basically every single penny that is raised by these guys go to help kids in Nepal who are doing it tough.
How beautiful is that?
It's gorgeous. It's a really beautiful event. Everybody donates their time. They donate all the stuff that is needed to hold the event. And
best of food and beverages in WA. Amazing food stations, drinks, entertainment and market stores.
That's
all
right.
In a secret location. Can you tell us where it is?
I don't know where it is,
secret.
Actually.
And raising money for, like we said, Kathmandu Kids. Chefs include Don Hansey.
That's right. And
Kerry Fraser.
Jerry Fraser.
And Belinda Cipriano.
No, I won't be, but I will be there actually. So I'm looking forward to that. The team there do a really amazing job, and not only do they raise money for children in Nepal, they also do a lot for charity here in WA as well.
Now, if you want to go, early bird tickets,
$99. That's right.
And late release is $125. The event starts at 7 p.m. and tickets can be purchased from www.kathmandukids.com.au/blah blah blah. You see it on the screen.
Yep.
Check out the details. Google it. Anything else you want to tell me?
Oh, not a lot. Really excited to be getting out and about, and it's getting warmer and the events
You're
are
loving
wrapping up.
Summer, aren't you? You've got lots of birthday parties.
I'm a summer girl. I am a mermaid. I love swimming in the ocean, and I like getting out and about.
So. And you know how most people, when they have all their school friends, they go to the 21st and 30s. You said you go to a 60th. I'm thinking, you don't look that old. You look good for 60. You're looking really... We don't talk age on this show.
No, we don't. I'm 21 forever. What are you talking about?
Well, that's been my... Funny enough, that's been my weight for years.
I know, it's like, oh, 21. God, it's the 40th, the 50th, the 60th and the funerals.
Stop going. Jesus. Do what I do. Stop going. I'm sick. I can't turn up. BelindaCipriano.com.au. Have we got a website for Belinda?
We do.
We have? We don't want to put it up?
No.
Yeah, it's up.
We will eventually.
Belinda Cipriano, they're going to put it up. They're going to do it in post, they reckon.
Good to
see you,
friend.
As it changes before the night. Yeah. Belinda Cipriano. Com. Please support her with a book. Thank you for coming in. We're hopefully going to see you on our final show for November the 1st when we record it.
We'll get some Christmas events happening.
Off to a birthday party or two.
Yep.
There is. Before we go, I'm going to get you to pronounce this one. We've got a fantastic lady called Caroline and our very own Nisha coming in. Do you know what they're talking about?
Dinner en Blanc.
Say it again.
Dinner en Blanc.
It's coming up. Check out the trailer. Thank you, Belinda.
Thanks, Fred.
Wonderful event coming up in Perth very, very soon. Nisha's got more details, and we've also got a very special guest, the promoter, here. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Fred. And we have Caroline James from Caroline James Events.
Thank you, Nisha. Thank you for having me here today.
We're really excited to have you on board because we're talking about the Dinner en Blanc, which is a very famous event around the world, but it's happening in Perth, which is very exciting for all West Australians watching.
Is indeed.
So tell us a bit about Le Dinner en Blanc. What's it all about? Why is it such a secret?
So Nisha, so Dinner en Blanc is a worldwide event where thousands of people come together, all dressed in white, come together at a secret location.
You look lovely today, by the way.
Thank you. A little bit on theme. They come together at a secret location, but an iconic venue to celebrate and have a pop-up picnic under the stars. This year's event rescheduled to the 7th of November. At another secret location, we're expecting over 2,000 guests to join us for dinner that evening.
How fantastic. And it's in its 5th anniversary. Can you tell us about some of the previous locations? Might give us a clue as to what exciting places you have the event at.
Yes, indeed. So we've been all over the Perth metro area over the past 5 years. Mm-hmm. So the event started at Elizabeth Quay. Mm-hmm. The next year we were down at the Esplanade in Fremantle. Mm-hmm. We then went to the urban setting of Yagan Square. Mm-hmm. Then last year we held the event at Crown Parklands, mm-hmm. next to Crown Perth. So Beautiful. This year we'll keep you guessing.
Very exciting trajectory, and there are some very specific guidelines for the event though, which makes it all that more alluring. What are they?
There are a few rules and guidelines just to keep the event, I suppose, all about Dinner en Blanc. So mm-hmm. head-to-toe white mm-hmm. outfits for the ladies and the gentlemen. Mm-hmm. Everyone brings their own picnic, so that's their own, including their table, including their chairs, their tableware, their white napkin for the napkin wave, mm-hmm. And the white table linen. So they can bring their own picnic, mm-hmm. Or they can pre-order one and collect there at the venue as well.
Wonderful. Now, how do people actually find the secret location? I'm quite interested in how you keep something so top secret these days.
Yes, so everyone is a little tight-lipped about the location. So we have a team of 100 volunteers, wow. as part of the Dinner en Blanc family. Mm-hmm. Guests, once they've received their ticket, they register online and then they choose one of their departure points. We've got 17 around the Perth metro area, so guests arrive with their friends at their secret or at their departure point. Mm-hmm. Their volunteer will then lead them to the secret location, so that might be by train, on foot, by bus. It's kept them guessing to the very end.
That's so fantastic, and I understand that this actually started in Paris. Tell us the story behind.
It does. Well, the story goes back over 30 years ago when mm-hmm. Francois Pasquier was arranging a rendezvous with some old college friends. Mm-hmm. Their reunion was taking place under the Eiffel Tower, so they said, let's all dress in white so we can find each other.
That is such a good idea. I wish I'd think of that when I was trying to find people.
That's it. and voila. So that's where the Dinner en Blanc story started. The event now runs across 80 cities in 30 countries around the world.
Wow, it's like the United Nations of events, isn't it? That's fantastic. Now, there's great selfie opportunities at the event. Tell us about that.
There are. So the event actually has a couple of traditional moments that are held every mm-hmm. year. So we have the napkin wave. Mm-hmm. Everyone celebrates the beginning of dinner with flying their white napkin in the air. We then open the dance floor with the sparkler moment. Oh, so cool. Everyone receives 2,000 people with their sparklers in the air.
Yeah, we can
signifies
see that there. Beautiful.
The opening of the dance floor. So we also collaborate with some really great event partners. We have NX Perth and Forest Chase. They will be having a pop-up beauty bar mm-hmm. for the little touch-up in the evenings. Mm-hmm. We also have a BMW Auto Classic with some BMWs on display.
White, of course.
And we also have a beautiful selfie activation with Howard Park Jetty. So lots of beautiful moments for the Instagram.
Oh, beautiful. Okay, now no picnic is without refreshments. So food and drinks, are they available as well as able to be brought by yourself when you go?
Absolutely. So guests are welcome to bring their own food. Mm-hmm. However, we have collaborated this year with Hayter & Shears mm-hmm. Catering. So executive chef from Hayter & Shears has mm-hmm. curated the most beautiful mm-hmm. French-inspired menu. Mm-hmm. So you can choose a picnic hamper or a vegan, vegetarian, charcuterie, fromage, or a dessert box and collect at the venue. And then the event is fully licensed. So mm-hmm. we've also got pre-ordered champagne from Laurent Perrier available. Mm-hmm. And then we love to support our local West Australian wineries. So a range of bubbles on option from Howard Park with their Jetty and Vinacious wines as well.
Sounds amazing. Now, for everyone watching at home, you do need to be invited to get a ticket to this event. So how do people go about that? Maybe you look down our camera one there and let everyone know.
So we do have a few more tickets remaining for the 7th of November's event. So if you jump online to perth.dinneronblanc.com, you can purchase your tickets for $62 plus a $15 membership fee, mm-hmm. and we'll send you an invitation to secure your place at this year's Dinner en Blanc.
Caroline, thank you so much for joining us. Sounds like an amazing, well-thought-out event, and we're looking forward to having you back on the couch sometime very soon.
Thank you, Nisha. Thanks so much for having us today.
Absolute pleasure. Now, of course, if you've missed any of that, you can go to thecouch.com.au, our Facebook page, but for now, it's back to you, Fred.
Thank you very much. And Caroline, quick question. I've got the menu here in front of me. Is it okay if I just tick all of the above?
Please do.
I think it's wonderful. It sounds like an amazing event. It's happening again. Where did you say it was going to be again?
Yeah, no.
worth a try. It'll be fantastic. Get your clothes together, white, get an invitation, become a member, support local events. It's going to be the best ever event, especially to top off the year, I think, as well. Please check out our website, as Nisha said. We're going to take a break as I choose another menu meal. And we'll be back with more of The Couch right after this. Gary Mitchell's coming up, sweet and sour, and much more. Years of friendship. We'll talk to him next. Welcome back to The Couch here on Aurora Television on Foxtel. We have got a friend of mine that has been around TV for a very long time, and today we're bringing him on as a maybe future councillor. Gary Mitchell, thank you for coming in.
Fred, nice to have you, sir.
And look, can I say, always a pleasure.
Congratulations to you too.
Yes.
Last man standing broadcasting at the moment.
There's not much television left in Perth.
No, but, you know, we are it, really.
I agree.
I'm not on air at the moment.
Well, you're
I'm
still
Zooming.
Doing your TV show online. There's still television.
Online, but maybe next year we'll be back when everything opens up. But you are last man standing on community TV.
Or sitting, as it may be. But let's talk a little bit about, I'm going to talk a little bit about Gary Mitchell. Tell the people at home, because you're running for the City of Perth councillor.
I am. I'm running for council in the City of Perth.
What made you do that? Well, because I know
that COVID, really?
Really?
Well, I think so, yes, because a lot of people over the years have said, well, you know, you always volunteer for this, that and the other thing. And I've been a community volunteer since I was probably 18.
Well, I've known that you've been doing community stuff for about over 20 years.
Yeah,
with
and well, that would only make me 38, so I'm glad you put the maths together like that. That's
But is it something you've just said, oh, well, why not do it? I know your cousin Basil's running for Lord Mayor.
Yeah.
But it's a big decision to go into public life, isn't it?
Oh, well, how public is it? You know, and given that, I've been in the public for a long time, that really wasn't a consideration. The consideration was, did I have the time to do it?
Mm-hmm.
Was I motivated to do it? And more than anything, was I sufficiently frustrated to put my hand up? And I suppose the answer is yes.
What would you like to see happen for the City of Perth into the future? Say you get elected. Let's forget whoever becomes a Lord Mayor. What is Gary Mitchell going to do as a councillor that he would love to improve the City of Perth for all of us?
Okay. Now, governance issues aside, because I've got a pretty good track record on governance, which is half the reason I thought I'd go in, because they're needing that at this point in time. I just thought, really, we all love our city. We all love a city and we all gravitate towards a city that's lively and enticing, and it's probably not celebrating that at the moment. So I just want to be part of that team that gets it back to having events,
so
enticing
what's
people back.
Lacking? You say events, I agree with you. It's things like the carols by candlelight, things like have a barbecue out in the park, the sky show, all these things, but there can be so many more.
Of course.
Do you think it's important to bring the people back to Perth?
Of course it is. It doesn't matter where you go. And even from an economic perspective, it's not just about the landowners having their tenancies full. It's also about the hotels being full because you've got tourists coming in and they're happy to stay in the centre of Perth. This is our capital city. And it's quite vacant at the moment and it's looking very grubby. And I think, number one, you start cleaning it up and you start organising with landowners and with, tenancy holders and all that sort of thing, to start making it more accessible as well, because the City of Perth has been a very expensive place to go and shop.
Do you think we need to make it more competitive as well? Because we talk a lot about the shopping centres out there. Everybody says, I go to the shopping centre.
Always, it's easier to go to the shops.
The parking is terrible in the city. It's expensive.
It's expensive.
It's not easy to get to. The shops aren't cheap. There's no big sales anymore.
Because there are constant sales.
Correct.
Wherever you go. Yeah,
so agreed. There needs to be a change in thinking, I guess, and that's where you would come in with your, ground level, I guess, normal person's view, a businessman, because you've been a businessman as well. So you have a lot of insights that you can say to them, look, this is where you're going wrong. And I guess part of that role as a councillor, would
Fred,
you talk to people?
You can see it. I don't think we're reinventing the wheel.
No.
It's just that you need, I suppose, people to roll up their sleeves and say, come on, let's sit down together and let's work out how we will get our people back. And you've hit the nail on the head. It's expensive to drive into the city and park for an hour where it costs you a minimum of, $4 before, you know, even for 10 minutes.
Yeah, I agree.
You know, if you can get in there for half an hour, and it doesn't cost you anything, you might go there because you've got the greatest variety.
And look, I used to work in Bankwest Tower a few years ago, and I used to park in Central Park. It was $50 a day. Come on, let's get serious. $50? Who earns that much to be able to? Because
not
I didn't want to
many.
Work. I didn't want to walk. I used to park across the road, but it's ridiculous. I mean, I went to Sydney and I watched the Sunrise program one day, and across the road there was, I think it was called St. Martin's Square.
Yeah.
And that cost me $60. It's ridiculous. We shouldn't be paying those sort of rates in the city of Perth. So I would hope that as a councillor, you will fix that up for us, because I think that's what people are saying. Make the city approachable, make the city
Fred, everyone
available.
Is saying that.
Yeah.
Everyone is saying, and it doesn't matter who you are. You know, the people who catch the buses who go into town even tell you, you know, parking doesn't affect us. Yeah. But I was wanting to meet my friend, whatever, yep. And, you know, they drive and they can't get into town. We do have another problem, though. We are the most car-thinking city yes. in Australia, and that's part of the problem. But our job isn't to change that thinking. The city, the state government have tried to do that.
Yep.
With a car levy, but it hasn't worked. All that's happened is there's been a huge amount of grant funds accumulating in the bank, and people are still wanting to drive in or not come in.
What's your take on opening hours for restaurants? Because I know I never
for came restaurants
in the city they close at 9 o'clock. By 9 o'clock the lights go out. It's almost like they say, "Look, you're the last person, Gary. Can you turn off the lights on the way out?"
Yeah.
Why
it's
do we
egg
have
and
them?
Chicken?
Yeah.
What comes first? Well, what comes first? No restaurateur is going to say, "I'm open till 12 o'clock, even though there's no people here." So what comes first? It's a bit of that.
Yep.
You know, the more you entice people in, the more there's a little bit of an impetus to say, "OK, I'm going to be open a little bit later." And that's what business owners do.
Mm-hmm.
They're there and their doors are open if they know people are going to come in and there's a spend happening. I'm not going to keep the lights on if no one's going to yep. come in. Well, you know, what am I doing? Decorating the joint.
Well, I know a lot of has been said by the Lord Mayor candidates about homelessness. Do you have a view on that yourself?
Yes, I do. And it's interesting because whilst it's a state government issue, it's everybody's issue. It's your issue.
Correct.
It's my issue. It's the result of so many different factors combining now, especially one where, look, volunteerism in our state has gone from the highest in Australia 30 years ago...
to the lowest.
Yeah. To the lowest, I single agree. Digits. You I know, where that. One in two people used to volunteer to help others in our community, now you've got 7%, 8%. What's that?
Mm.
That's certainly a factor, but I don't like people making political mileage out of those situations, but really it is incumbent on all of us
yep.
to wake up and say, listen, it's not about dollars anymore, it's about humanity, and
right.
we've got to get out there and offer a little bit of dignity. I look after... my sister tells yep. me off when I say that. I don't look after any homeless people. I look out for three homeless people
yes.
who squat, live at the back of my shop.
Yes.
And it's a wonderful thing, but I just check to see that they're okay. You know, if they need any food, if they need a shower, because my business has shower facilities there. And it's a mentality that we need to really all adopt. But in the main, it's making sure that the people have a roof over their heads so they can, when they're rough sleeping, out of choice because they don't want the attachments of whatever, everyone's got a very different story.
Yes.
But they get a better quality night's sleep and they don't have to take drugs to look out to see if someone's going to pinch their bits and pieces. If we can give them a roof over their head and they can have a decent night's sleep, that starts the cycle back to the real world.
That's
for
a good
them.
Start, isn't it? And it I think, is. As we said, and Tim also said it, the Lord Mayor candidate, people who live on the streets don't just do it, you know, just today I'm going to live on the street. They've also got other problems, mental health issues, breakups in families, financial issues.
Financial.
So we need to maybe help some of those other problems and then try and get people off the street.
One of the characters that is a mate of mine now that I look after, he does it as a means of looking after his kids. His kids aren't on the street.
Yep.
But he says he goes and does little odd jobs, gardening and this
yes.
and that, whatever, and the money that he acquires, he feeds himself, and then he passes on that money to his ex-wife for the sake of the kids. And he says, oh, you know, I'm better off for my kids doing that. He's got a lovely ethos. Yep. He looks after his own people first, but he figures that's his easiest way of looking after kids, kids.
Fantastic. So, people giving to people, going back to the old-fashioned thing, we're all community. We're all part of the community.
We should be.
Gary, have a look at camera two for us. Tell the people at home, 30 seconds, why they need to vote for you as a councillor.
Oh, you need to vote for me. You don't need to vote for me. You actually need to roll up your sleeves and decide to get involved in community. If you were all involved in community, I wouldn't need to put my hand up for the City of Perth. But if you're not going to put your hand up to do anything and get involved, I'll counsel you afterwards. But please give us a vote. What I want to do is make sure that people feel that they can come into the city from now on. I want to make sure that we've got our city looking vibrant again, so you want to come in, and I want to make sure that we're running the place properly as well. So give me a vote if you can. If not, roll up your sleeves and come in and do it yourself as well.
Gary Mitchell, it's been a wonderful opportunity to have you here. You've got a website for those people who want to follow you and maybe contact you.
Well, really, I haven't created anything additional. It's on Facebook page that I've had for years. Yep. So what have you got there? Yeah, that's my Facebook
page.
There
you go.
So you can see my sister, my mother, my, you know, all my bits and pieces.
A real
there.
Person.
My beautiful Olga, who lives in Melbourne and is stuck in the middle of COVID. We've been together for 10 years, but that's another story. She's over there.
Isn't it a true saying, be yourself, no one does it better, and that's what you are. You're just a normal everyday person that cares about people, cares about the community, and you know, and cares about doing a great TV show.
I'm a bit like you, Fred. Yeah. You're a good man too.
Not as good looking, but I have to say, Italian, Greek.
Beauty's in the eyes of the beholder. Where are you looking?
We both try and achieve the same thing. We do it differently, but it doesn't mean we're wrong or one's
You're very community-minded too, Sue.
And
we love it. Pushes our button. That's what we do.
And, you know, I hope everybody votes for you. Gary, we need a change in the council. We need new people, new breath of fresh air. We need carols by candlelight. We need lots of stuff in the city. Thank you for coming in.
Thank you, sir. I'm running you next time.
And now I've got someone very special centre stage for you. His name is Paul O'Neill. He's doing a beautiful opera song for Gary. It's called Nessun Dorme. Here he is.
Oh, beautiful.
Oh!
Paul O'Neill, if you're wondering who it is a wonderful West Australian opera singer, and he's hoping that for the borders to come down, Mr. McGowan, so he can actually travel overseas and shine on behalf of Western Australia. But please support him. Paul O'Neill, give him some work around Perth if you've got a place for him to perform. I'm sure there's plenty out there. Gary Mitchell, please vote for him in the next council elections.
Thanks, Fred.
You've got until the 17th of October to vote, and we hope he's one of the new councillors. Thank you to Gary. Thank you to you at home. We'll be back with more after the break. We'll do some cooking, Middle Eastern cooking, with Sandra Bubba. See you then.
Connect with The Couch online through Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube.
Welcome back to The Couch. It's time to talk about the elections for our City of Perth Council and Lord Mayor position. It's coming up. It's actually running at the moment. People have had mail-outs go out to them. They've had the postal ballot out to them so they can vote right now. And we're introducing someone who is going to be one of the candidates for the Lord Mayor, and her name is Sandy Angie. Did I get that right,
That's
Sandy?
That's right, Fred.
Welcome to The Couch.
Thank you for having me.
Congratulations on your nomination.
Thank you.
But I want to ask, because for those people who don't know a lot about Sandy, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Okay, so a little bit about me. I guess I've always lived in Perth. I was born and raised here, and I started actually my career as a lawyer. So I finished school in 91, and although I was passionate about being an architect back then, it was a recession, interest rates were 18%, it's probably hard to believe now, and so I was kind of talked out of studying architecture, there was no jobs at the time, and into law. So I then worked as a lawyer for 10 years before going back to university to pursue my passion of architecture.
Considering the former council that we've had, the legal side of your experience is probably a good thing.
Yeah, well, I think so. Like, even though, like, I went back to study architecture, I have no regrets about studying law first. I think, you know, I studied actually law and commerce together, but those skills really help you through life, and that's what's enabled me to also participate on not-for-profit boards for the last 10 years and give back to the community because of those skills.
So when you're looking at becoming Lord Mayor, because that's what you're running for, what are your key features? As a Lord Mayor, what will we get from Sandy?
Oh, well, hopefully, I think you'll get a lot of different skills from me, and, you know, that's my broad background of law, commerce and architecture, serving the community on not-for-profit boards, and, you know, I'm really passionate about Perth and, you know, arts and just our city in general. So all of that. And also, I've learnt a lot about the city in the last 4 years working on a project called...
What needs to be done? What have you learnt? Because I know that you're working really hard to find out what everybody thinks.
Yeah.
What have you learnt that people want to happen in our city?
Yeah, well, I think people want to see the city brought back to life, and that's the key part of my policy. And, you know, I've got three key focus areas to make that happen. First, I think we need to fix the fundamentals. These are things that we all agree on, helping people experiencing homelessness, dealing with safety in our city, helping businesses recover from COVID and just, you know, the general downturn before COVID even started. But I think we need even more than that. We need to build the identity of our city, you know, enhance what we've already got, and also, as well as all of that, celebrate what we have already, because it is a great place. There's work that needs to be done, but what we can do right now is start talking positively about the things that we do have.
See, I'd like to see something a little bit on the line that, down the line that, like, Sydney has.
Yeah.
I'd love to see cruise ships that have amazing dance shows, New Year's Eve shows, Australia Day type shows. I think the public has wanted more from the city, and obviously for different reasons with the council that we've had in the past, things didn't quite work out. I know a lot of people talk about Sky Show and free parking, but I think you need a lot more than just free parking to bring the city back to life. The homeless, for example, has been a big issue. How have you sort of handled that topic? Do you have an idea of how you would like to see the homeless dealt with?
Yeah, so I think there's two parts to that. I think, firstly, we need more homes, and that's a state government responsibility. But what the Lord Mayor can do is be a strong advocate with the government to encourage them to build more homes and work with them on that. But what the city can also do is provide interim solutions. And I think the people of Perth are really looking for leadership from the city on that. So that's something that I would look at doing straight away. It's just fund. There's so many great organisations that are actually able to help right now. They just need more funding, so we can do that.
And I believe there's a lot of buildings owned by the City of Perth, but also buildings owned by the state government, maybe even the federal government, community groups, sitting there in the city, not being used. And it'd be awesome if we could maybe get the state government to fund some of those renovations and transformations and make a beautiful, happy place for people to live. Look, I think car parks are wonderful as an interim with beds and that, but you want everybody in society to have a fair go.
Exactly.
And I don't see people, I'll be honest with you, I think telling someone that's homeless, we're going to move you into a car park, it's almost giving it a priority that doesn't really give it any priority. It's like just pushing the problem on the side. I think you have to sort of resolve it by giving people a place to belong, a safe, clean place where they can get food, showers, warmth, and safety is a big thing as well. So I think you're on the ball with that one.
Yeah, thank you.
Are you looking at bringing events over to Perth? Do you see that we might be able to host more events?
Yeah, I think we definitely, I mean, I think planning around events is difficult now during COVID because we don't know when the borders will reopen. We don't know when we'll be able to have, you know, events without social distancing. So that's something that, you know, we're all talking about in Perth, but, you know, I guess with caution at the moment. But definitely everyone I talk to, local businesses, the residents, they all want to see more happening in Perth. And that can be things like supporting community groups in our city. There's a lot of community groups that have sprung up in our neighbourhoods, East Perth Community Group, West Perth Local, Historic Heart of Perth, which I was a part of. You know, and by funding those organisations, you not only help create events, but you also help bring the community together in creating events. So there's this kind of grassroots things that we can do, as well as the bigger events and attractions as well. I think you need the whole scale, community groups, and then the big events that we can bring in.
Oh, look, I think it's a wonderful plan, and at least you do have a plan, and a lot of people have got a one-topic plan, which I think is just safety, security, police, and homeless. There's a lot more to a city than just those things. Yep. They're important, but everything's important to different people. You know, one thing I would love to see the Lord Mayor do, move out of the city of Perth at times and have meetings with the public in all areas.
Totally.
Because we all own the city. We all love the city of Perth. We're 5 minutes from here to the city, so I still care about what happens in the city. But I don't necessarily live in the city, but I do business in the city. So I would love the Lord Mayor maybe to go out to Morley and have a forum there and ask people, what do you think of the city of Perth? What do we need? And it gives you new people to ask and new opinions. And I think that might be a great thing. How hard has it been running for the Lord Mayor? Is this the first time you've run for election?
Oh, yeah, I've never done anything like this before in my life. And it's been fun. It's been hard work. It's been 24-7 since I launched.
What's the hardest thing about the 24-7 would be hard?
Yeah, but, you know, it's actually quite energising because meeting people every day, you know, you get a lot of great feedback. You're learning something new every day. And I think if you take it from the perspective of what can I learn each day from the people that you meet, then it's really energising. And especially in the last couple of weeks since the ballots have gone out, and I've kept door knocking. And, you know, then you knock on someone's door and they say, yeah, I've already voted for you and nice to meet you, and you have a chat, and, you know, or getting text messages where people have taken a photo of the ballot with the tick and sent it to me. And
people are actually interested.
And people
they?
Are interested, and people are also taking the care in making the decision and calling with questions before they vote. And it just, that actually keeps you going because you think people care about this election. You know, they're looking into who they'd choose, and, you know.
Well, I think it's the first time I remember in my life living in Perth. There's been, I think, what, 7 or 8 candidates?
Yeah, it's unprecedented,
I think
apparently.
There's only ever been 2 or 3.
Yep.
And I've never known there to be 7 or 8 candidates. So we've got a lot of choice. So if you look at camera 2 for me.
Okay.
Free. Tell the people of Perth why, out of those 7 or 8 candidates, why you need to be selected out of those.
Okay. Well, hopefully you will choose me when you fill out your ballot form. For the reason why is this: I've lived in Perth all of my life. I've lived in this, and worked in the city since 1997, and through a broad range of careers, learning lots of skills that I could bring to the role of Lord Mayor. As I said before, I've worked through law, accounting, and architecture. I've worked in a not-for-profit project in the city for the last 4 years, learning so much about our city from residents, from local businesses, from key stakeholders. I've seen the internal workings of the city, and I feel like I have a head start on that. As well as that, I think I've got the right vision to fix the fundamentals, establish our identity, and celebrate what we already have. Thanks, everyone.
Well done, Sandy. And Sandy, I asked you at the off-air, have you got a group of people that are running with you, running mates, as they call them, or is it you're running on your own?
No, I'm running a completely independent
campaign.
See,
that interests me. I like that. I like that about you, independent. Yep. Do you think that if you were to win the role of Lord Mayor, can you bring the council with you? Can you actually, is there a plan by you to try and unify the people that are there to work together?
Absolutely. I think we should all work as a team. It's all independent individuals as part of one team. And, you know, that's something, I guess, that's been my experience of being on not-for-profit boards where, you know, everyone comes to it with different skills. What can everyone bring to the table and contribute as a team? So that's really important.
First 30 days as Lord Mayor, what's on your agenda as most
well,
important?
Well, I've actually, well, on my website, I've got a plan for my first 100 days,
100
which is
days.
10 things. So sandyangie.com. And these are the things that are my top priorities. But I think first up, everyone I talk to wants to see free parking in the city on weekends. It's a
Even
huge
Christmas.
Barrier to getting families into the city. You know, huge barrier for people
to
come
to
and shop and eat.
I'd love to see outdoor cinemas in the city.
Well, all those things. And I've also, the other thing that I've committed in my first 100 days is to fund the community groups to run Christmas events in every one of our neighbourhoods, not just the CBD, but from east to west, you know, have Christmas all over our city for everyone.
No, you've got a genuine approach to this.
Thank
done.
You,
you're one of my favourites, I'll say.
Thank you.
I mean, everyone's my favourite, so don't bring up and say you're... But I think one thing that I like about people being down to earth, talking plain truth, and you know what I'd love you to do for me, if you do, you've got plenty of time, you've still got a couple of months before Christmas, I'd love to see Carols by Candlelight come back to the city of Perth. So if you can make that happen,
that would
I'll
be
telling everyone to vote for you, Sandy.
Oh, thank you so much.
This is Sandy Andrews. She's
thank
one of the Lord Mayor candidates. You've got an opportunity until the 17th, I believe, of October. We'll know who wins. You've got your ballots now. Please put them in if you haven't already done it. This is one of those candidates. And thank you very much. Good luck with the elections. And I look forward to having you back here.
Thank you.
After you win, and we can talk about those carols by candlelight.
Definitely.
But thank you very much. And have a wonderful time. Enjoy it as well.
Thank you.
Earlier today, I got the opportunity to speak to a fantastic author that works right here at Side Education in Leaderville. Her name is Annie Chandler Cumming. She's got three books. Here's that interview. Time now on the couch to talk to an amazing author and teacher. She's part of the furniture here at Side where we record our fantastic show. Her name is Annie Chandler Cummings. Welcome to the couch. Nice to have you here.
Thank you very much, Fred.
Annie, tell us a little bit about yourself and your background and then we'll talk about your books.
I'm a special needs teacher, or that's what I've been doing for more years than I care to remember. And I am now semi-retired, which is lovely. Mm-hmm. And currently I'm working with the RTO at Side, writing some course material for students for their foundation level vocational studies.
Well, what got you into writing books?
I've always loved writing. I've always loved reading. And I was the child that loved it when they said it was silent reading or when we had to write a story. Mm. I loved writing them. So I started writing many years ago. I still have some in paper form. This is pre-computers, some typed up on the old typewriter. So it was just time. I never had the time before. And unfortunately, I never had the support before until my current husband, which sounds like I've had a lot. I'm not quite Elizabeth Taylor. But he said, it's time now to
write your books.
And finish them off. I'll support
There's
you.
There's three that I've got on the desk here, which we'll see on screen very soon. But tell us the type of books that you've written. I know these two here. Talk about those two first, The Daisy in the Field and A Lily in the Valley. They were the first two that you've written.
That's correct. They're part of the Flower Quartet, so there's another two books. One's already at a publisher going through the editing process, and I've started the fourth one. So A Rose in the Garden is being published at the moment, and A Poppy in the Field I'm currently writing.
Now, I'm assuming the books don't have anything to do with flowers.
They have to do with the people's names.
Ah, okay.
So, yes. They're about four women in one family over three generations. Mm-hmm. And it's about finding love again. So they are of the romance genre, but I also like to include into each book some kind of current issue.
Wow.
Yeah. And they also relate to the first three having husbands in the armed forces.
Okay.
and being, well, the first two being widowed. So there is
any true stories there as a research point? Have you used real people that you know, or have you, it's all fiction?
It's basically all fiction, but like any writer, I've had to do research. So I've had to do research into the Vietnam War, into the Afghanistan War, and also looking at PTSD and things like that. So anything I've done has had to have a background of some truth to it.
I know you said it's a romance novel, the two books of romance. What type of audience are these targeted at? Who would be the best audience to get the book and to read it? Who's your demographics?
Demographics are basically women, although the men who have read it have said they've enjoyed it. I suppose anyone from 80 through to, you know, whoever. Well, I'm in my 60s and I still like reading romance. Mm-hmm. A couple of my friends have given them to their mothers, and I got a lovely thank you card from an 87-year-old lady who said she loved them.
So tell me what people would get out of the two books. So if they went out and bought those books, what do you hope that you've created for them to enjoy?
I hope they feel the whole gamut of emotions, because there is sadness in there. As the stories come out, there of course is love, but there's also a bit of drama as well. So there's a bit of everything, I think, to tease. And I mean, I write to entertain. And I know a lot of people poo-ha romance writers because they think we're sort of the lowest fish in the writing genres. But I believe there is a huge audience who want to just get into something different. They don't want to be scared. They don't want to be frightened or thrilled or something. They want just to read something that is light and enjoyable.
And I guess easy achievable too, something that affects their life. So it sounds a fantastic read, both those books. But tell us about 60 and Sassy. Is this your own personal book?
That is my own personal book. Last year I turned 60.
Congratulations.
Thank you for reaching that milestone. And I had started to think about it beforehand, and I thought, right, I want to have a look at the funny parts of turning 60, because let's face it, you know, their knees go, the hips go, the joints go,
You reckon the hair that goes at 60? I reckon that went at about 51.
Well, exactly.
But you're right.
Yeah.
So you want to take the opportunity, I guess, to do as much as you can.
Yes.
While you can.
It's just, it's my humorous look. It's humorous. A few people have said it's sort of wet your knickers funny, which is very easy at 60 because it happens a lot. So I've been, you know, very forthcoming in a lot of the things that go wrong with the human body at that time.
So people can expect some good surprise and good laughs.
Good laughs.
Would it be something you'd read on a plane, maybe if we're ever allowed to travel, or would it be something you could sit back leading up to Christmas, maybe something over Christmas? I'm assuming the people in Victoria would probably love to read all three at the moment.
Look, that one, it's 35,000 words or thereabout. Yep. It's a quick, easy read. There are other books coming in the series, so I'm doing 70 and Sexy next, although I think I'm actually going to go back to 50 and Flirty.
50 and Flirty,
aging, 50 and Flirty, yes, aging frivolously.
Have you achieved everything as an author that you thought would happen, or there's more to do?
Oh, there's more to do.
Are you going to change your name to something like, you know, sometimes people use a different name?
Look, because I was the Chandler and my husband's the Cummings, and I put it together because people said you've got to have a double-barreled name, and it kind of flows. So I think I'll leave it there. I know a lot of writers do write, like Bella Andre writes under a different name. Lucy Walker, who was a West Australian author, who's John Sanders, is her son.
Oh, wow.
I only found that out, not long ago. And she changed names. Look, I think...
Has anyone helped you with the book? The books, should I say? Anyone you want to thank?
Anyone. I want to thank my husband.
Yep.
He's my muse. He was the one who has supported me and said, now's the time to do it. But we also like to thank anyone that we speak with, because we write down things that have been said.
Yep.
So
and then maybe write about it later.
Oh, definitely write.
Now, Annie, where can people get the book? I know we've got a website and people can buy the books right now.
Yes. Basically, it's my website at the moment because I'm self-published.
There it is on screen right now.
Oh, lovely. And thank you. So if you send me a letter or an email. Letter. Goodness, God, I'm showing my... Yep.
I think we've got a graphic with all the books on there. 60 and Sassy, A Daisy in the Field and A Lily in the Valley. We do have a graphic with all those covers on there. Thank you very much. And we want people to go and buy the books from your website. It's that a great, read for Christmas or if you've got friends over East. Look, I'm looking forward to your next book. I hope you include us in the media release. Annie Chandler Cummings, one of our friends here from Side Education, but there's a different side to her. This is actually, pardon pun, different side to Annie. Of course, she's an author. And it sounds like it's a great read, humorous and romantic. Thank you very much for coming in today.
Thank you.
Wish you all the best in your future with being an author.
Thank you.
And lots of good books to read and write.
Well, I'm retiring next year, so it is going to be my occupation from then.
Best of luck with the books.
Thank you very much, Fred. Thank you.
What a fantastic author. Please support her. She's local, West Australian, and she's got more books coming, as she said. Now it's time to talk to another candidate for our Lord Mayor here in Perth. His name is Tim Swass. He's an ex-magistrate, and with him is our very own Nisha Seth.
Thank you so much, Fred. We have Mr. Tim Swass. Welcome to the couch.
Thank you very much. Pleasure to be here.
So, Tim, you're one of the candidates for the Perth Lord Mayor position. Coming up on the 17th of October, we'll be finding out who gets the seat.
Yes, 2 weeks' time, we'll know. I'll either be the mayor or I won't.
So, Tim, there's obviously a lot to focus on in Perth, given the trajectory of the previous Perth City Council, and very excited to have you on board today on the show to talk to us about what some of your focuses will be moving forward. But before we do that, for those that may not be familiar with your history and your background, can you tell us a bit about what you've been doing through the course of your career to date?
Well, my last job was 30 years as a magistrate in the Children's Court. Mm-hmm. Prior to that, I spent 2.5 years in Broome with the Legal Aid Commission, and prior to that, in Western Australia, I spent 10 years with the Welfare Department prosecuting care proceedings, which is a job that's not for the faint-hearted. I needed a break. I went up to Broome for the quiet life, and the weekend we drove into Broome. The Australian Navy towed in the first 6 Indonesian fishing boats. Monday morning I had 72 clients, none of whom could speak English, most of whom couldn't speak Indonesian, charged with offences under state and federal legislation that nobody in Australia had ever been charged with before. So much for the quiet life. It was a magnificent challenge legally and logistically, and I thoroughly enjoyed the experience.
Like you said there, Tim, not for the faint-hearted. When you're working in such a human rights compassionate area, I imagine that takes really a lot of your own, I guess, purpose and passion and focus to stay in that for decades.
Well, I received some profound advice very early on, and that is if you know what you're doing, a stressful job or a difficult job shouldn't be stressful. And so I made it my business to always be the most knowledgeable person in that courtroom, be it as a lawyer or as a lawyer. And the way to learn about child abuse, of course, apart from dealing with it, is to go to the conferences. And they're dovetailed so that one year there's an international conference on child abuse and neglect. The following year there's a one in Australia. And I used to go every year and meet the top people from around the world dealing with child abuse. And I found that of great comfort and inspiration to keep on going. One of the things they said very early was, never look forward because it's too daunting. Just look back and see what you have achieved and use that to keep you going.
Thank you for sharing that with us. It's really sound advice. And I think also really importantly, sitting in the candidacy seat at the moment, is we want someone who is measured and evidence-based in their approach, which is important. And you also mentioned governance to me when we were talking earlier. How important is good governance right now for the Perth City Council?
Well, we had a $7.2 million inquiry that you and I are going to pay for, either as ratepayers or taxpayers. And that found, of course, that what was lacking in the previous council was leadership and good governance. And the commissioner who did the inquiry set out 341 recommendations as a blueprint for how the the council should proceed. And the commissioners that have been running the council for the last 2.5 years have put many of those recommendations in place. Mm. And, of course, it's all to do with transparency and democracy in action, and a lot of it is to do with the meetings. And the commissioner in recommendation 51 recommended that all council meetings, committee meetings and council meetings be streamed live, be recorded.
Good transparency, yes.
Absolutely. Mm. And I suggested that on my website some time earlier. So I said at first, we agree. And if I have anything to do with it, I'll do that. I've made a point of looking at other council meetings all around Australia. I've been to a couple of local ones, council meetings. I've seen the commissioners in Perth, which are sort of atypical because there's only the three of them there, the formalities of a council meeting. But I'm familiar with how other capital cities in Australia do their council meetings, and there is a preferred way to do it, and that is to have it where the decisions are made. Everyone can see what's been done, and you'll be able to watch it on the on the City of Perth website instead of watching Channel 7. You can watch your rates being spent, and if you don't like it, send an email.
So what I'm hearing is that it's really important for our public to be engaged in a really transparent way, especially not just being ratepayers, but also being citizens of Perth, of Western Australia in essence, and what you've done to achieve that alongside all of your decades of experience having a balanced perspective, but is also making sure that you've got all of the information about best practice or what's been working well elsewhere and folding that into what we do here potentially moving forward.
Well, there's two things there. One is the use of expertise, and of course I make it clear that I'm an expert in nothing except using expertise. I know where to go and get the experts and how to get the benefit of what's worked in other places and how it can be adopted and adapted here. The other thing, of course, is the point you're making is that you need, as the Commissioner said in his inquiry, that you need to have community consultation. What the previous council lost was that it was there for the benefit of the ratepayers, and sort of people dealing with the council kept on complaining that every time they had a suggestion there were 10 reasons why it couldn't be done. There's been a change in the culture since, and a number of people have said to me who deal regularly with the council that there has been a change now when they go with a proposal. Rather than reasons why it's too difficult, they've made suggestions as to how it could be done better.
Good.
Which is pleasing to see, and it's something that needs to be built on and encouraged.
Wonderful. So moving forward from a leadership perspective as well, what do you think you're going to be adding as Perth Lord Mayor in comparison to other candidates that have their hat in the ring, so to speak?
Well, there's a considerable overlap between natural justice and good governance. If you put the two side by side, it's all variously described, but any list of the attributes of one has overlaps with the other, giving everybody a fair hearing, transparency, and, of course, giving reasons for your decision. The inquiry, of course, referred to a number of instances where decisions on important matters were made without any reasons being given. And the inquiry, of course, uncovered why those somewhat odd decisions were made, and of course they were made for all the wrong reasons. And of course I'm used to making decisions that are defended, contested, giving reasons. Everything as a magistrate that you say is recorded, transcripts made if it's asked for, and anybody who's unhappy can go and get the matter reviewed or appealed in the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court are there to make sure you don't err.
So you're very much used to having that balanced perspective for many, many years. Moving forward, I know we talked about a lot of issues that are in Perth at the moment. Good governance is a very solid base. What are some of the areas that you will focus on? I know there's a strategy in place that's been left there, but are there any particular areas that you're wanting to focus on as Lord Mayor?
Well, I haven't come with any plans of my own because there's plans in place for pretty much everything already. The homeless one, of course, is an alliance to end homelessness in Perth. People think that I'm the first one to go around saying we've got to end homelessness. That's not the case. There's a 10-year plan in place. We're 2 years into that. And that plan has as its aim is to end it. It's been done in other places. It can be done in Perth, I'm sure, with the right resources and the right plan. There is the plan. It's just a matter of turbocharging it, and what's needed pretty much straight away is perhaps 1,000 beds for temporary supported accommodation. And when you think about it, people that end up on the street have problems before they end up on the street. That's why they're on the street.
It's complex.
And of course, having heard from people who've had the lived experience and indeed spoken to people who are still on the streets, if you are on the streets, you don't eat well, you don't sleep well, and your health problems, and particularly your mental health problems, get rapidly worse. Then you end up in a hospital bed, which costs $1,500 a day. The average day for a psychiatric patient is 10 days. If my maths are right, I think that's $15,000. Mm-hmm. And you can get an awful lot of temporary supported accommodation for $15,000. And the health department spent $1 billion in WA on mental health, and they spend very little of that on prevention. Providing a home to somebody is prevention. And I'm sure that not using a loud voice but quiet persuasion, we can persuade the Minister for Health, Mr Cook, to part with some of his money to assist in providing temporary supported homes for those people who would otherwise end up in his hospitals. Yeah.
Tim, thank you so much for joining us on the couch today. You're obviously a very learned gentleman. You've got a lot of experience in this space. Where can people find out more about you if they're interested, particularly in any of the singular points in more detail? You can just let our camera know here your website.
I have a website. It's timswas.com.au. Everything is on there. It's all substance. There's no Make America Great slogans or anything. Unfortunately, I could have had some of those on there. I would have gone for the French, I think, you know, liberté, égalité, fraternité, you know. That would be my favourite slogan, but the French can keep that. I haven't gone with anything. I've just gone with substance.
Wonderful. Well, thank you. Very respect your time. All the best coming up to the election on the 17th of October, and look forward to engaging with you again soon on the couch.
Thank you. Look forward to it.
Wonderful. If you've missed any of that, sorry, Mind is still processing all of that information, you can go to thecouch.com.au or visit our Facebook page as well. But for now, it's back to you, Fred.
Thank you, Nisha. Tim, question for you. I think Nisha was a bit soft with you. I'm going to get to... Look, I have to say, because I want people at home to see that there's a human side to Tim as well. You're a family man, you've got a family. What sort of stuff does Tim do when he's not a magistrate, when you're not a lawyer? What are you into?
Fishing.
You love fishing.
I go fishing. We're very keen on fishing. My wife's a very good fisher person. She catches more fish than I do. I say she does it under my supervision. She doesn't agree with that. Fishing, if you have a boat, you'll never be wondering what to do with your time.
And do you ever sit back at home and just watch a good station like Channel 9?
I don't watch much television.
That's not a bad thing either.
I tend to read.
Yep.
I watch a little bit of YouTube, odd sort of things there. Music, I'm very fond of jazz music, and you can watch all sorts of performances there.
There's a person behind the future Lord Mayor there too. Look, it's really important, I think, for people to see that the reason I asked him that is because I know Tim has spent many, many years as a magistrate. As a magistrate, you get to learn a lot about people to make the decision on whether they're guilty, not guilty, or whether they're going to be given a different type of sentence. And I think it's important for people to know, though Tim is into governance, because that's what his life has been like. He's into running things properly, doing things legal. I think from my point of view, Tim, I can see you not having an issue working with the council made up of a lot of different people and adding a bit of a human side to it as well. Look, Tim, as we did with all the other candidates, can I ask you to look at camera 2 and just tell people over here, Tim, it is something you're good with television.
Everyone's got one on it.
That's one, but I like this camera for you. But if you could tell the people of Perth why they need to vote for you in about 30 seconds.
Hello, my name's Tim Swass. I'm running for Lord Mayor of Perth. What I bring is leadership and good governance. The inquiry, $7.2 million worth, found that that's what was lacking, and it's something that I can provide. I've sat in the big chair for 30 years as a magistrate. I know how to make decisions. I know how to treat people fairly. I know how to ensure that reasons for the decisions are given in a way that shows the manner in which you made the decision, the merits of the case, and I don't have any difficulty in seeing myself conducting council meetings and then attending to the issues. I don't have any conflicts. I've never been employed by anybody in Perth other than the state government, and I anticipate being able to deal with everything in a proper manner.
Congratulations, and all the best for the election.
Thank you.
And I'm sure we're going to see a lot more of Tim Swass no matter what happens at the council election. I can see a future in politics as well, maybe down Tim saying, no, I want to go. Tim no, wants to go it. Fishing. I think he wants to go fishing.
Well, thank you, Nisha. Retirement. Yeah.
Thank you, Tim, and enjoy your fishing. Hopefully we get some good weather
for it too. Okay, well, you can go to my website and have a look at the gallery if you do nothing else.
That's it. We'll take a break. We'll take a break here on the couch. Here's a next candidate, and I hope you can make up your mind with that as well. We'll take a break on the couch. We'll be back with more of it after this.
Connect with The Couch online through Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube.
What a big day on the couch. I hope you've enjoyed the show today. But it's not over yet. We're going to do some cooking now in the kitchen with Nisha Seth. And we're doing Middle Eastern rice and beef. Over to you, Nisha.
Thank you, Fred. Very excited for another Fresh and Local segment. Welcome back, Sandra.
Thank you very much.
What are we cooking today?
We're doing an Arabic dish called hashweh.
Hashweh.
Yeah.
Wonderful. So as we get started, maybe you can talk us through some of the ingredients.
I shall. Okay. So we have the usual beautiful Arabic spices. We've got Arabic mixed spice here, which has got cloves, cinnamon, nutmeg, all the goodies. Mm-hmm. So cool. That one's great. We've also got black pepper. So that's just the usual staple, obviously. Mm-hmm. And then we've got cinnamon.
Lovely.
Which is, it just adds a really nice sweetness. And then we've got nutmeg.
Lovely. Wonderful. All available from good supermarkets.
Yes.
I'm sure.
And obviously we've got salt as well.
Salt that we can see there. Beautiful. Yeah.
And as well, we are going to use about 1.5 cups of rice. You can use any medium grain, basmati, whatever. It's whatever your preference is.
Beautiful. Now tell us a bit about the dish. You've got some cooking here. So what's the first step?
So we've also got about 200 grams of beef mince. Mm-hmm. You can also use lamb mince if you want to. We've been frying this off just in a pan, and we are going to spice it. Mm-hmm. So hashweh is like a dish that we use as a stuffing. It's not just, you can have it on its own like this with some roast chicken and salad. Or you can have it like stuffed in capsicum, stuffed in grape leaves, stuffed in cabbage, basically stuffed in everything.
So many different cultural traditions have this form of dish, right? But there's just different elements to it. You don't put onion in yours?
No onion. Okay. No, that's kind of sacrilege.
Okay,
so.
Sure. No problem.
So what we're going to do, we're going to add half the spices in now, now that it's cooked. This thing's like a slip and slide
so
on the pot.
It's nice and brown?
Yes, and it's nice and brown, so I'll show you. We just put a teaspoon of salt in there, and we've just browned it off, so you want no red bits in there for now.
Okay, sure.
So
wonderful.
We're just gonna add the salt now, and then now we also got the nutmeg. So nutmeg is kind of the key flavor of the dish, but you obviously don't want to put too much because it can be quite overpowering. So we're gonna put half a teaspoon in there right now, and then we'll add another half a teaspoon in a second.
Lovely.
Then we've got about a teaspoon of cinnamon. We'll mix this all together. It'll be delicious.
Chocolate?
Like cocoa?
Yes.
Yeah, it's going to have a really bitter taste. So half a teaspoon of black pepper.
Wonderful.
It has to be black. And then we've got the Arabic mixed spice. We put quite a lot of this because it's got a really nice flavour profile.
Wonderful.
So we've got 1 heaped tablespoon of that.
Okay, so as you mix that through, can you tell us a bit about what you've been up to at Meast?
Sure. So I've been doing a lot more private catering and cooking classes. I've been going to people's houses and cooking
really?
For them.
Really? So you go to people's houses, cook, and they learn while you're
cooking? Yeah. I mean, they learn, but also they socialise.
Yes.
So
okay.
They kind of let me cook a lot of the time, and then they just watch.
How cool is that?
Yeah, it's really
so
it's
birthdays,
like a nice,
christenings, like different
engagement
events,
parties.
Engagement parties.
Yeah,
okay.
It's great. Yeah. It's birthdays are probably the most common.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's really nice because they can just relax and if they can participate as much as they want or not. So.
Oh, awesome. Yeah. And what I guess what types of dishes? Would it be dishes like this that you're making?
Yeah,
or
I made this like a fattoush salad, which is like salad with bread on top.
Okay.
Yeah. Do roast chicken.
Yeah. And cater to different, like if someone is vegan.
Celiac or everything.
Wonderful. Okay.
So we're just going to add the rice in now. So we've got 1.5 cups of medium grain rice here. Yes. We've washed it because you want to get the starch out. Beautiful. And we're just going to put that all in there.
Okay, lovely.
Yep. And then we just got to mix that through. And I will just mix this here.
This is quite a quick dish.
It's super quick, but honestly, it's one of the most tastiest dishes and it's so Moorish.
Beautiful.
We're going to add a bit more spice now. So we're going to add another half a teaspoon. Oh, I honestly sometimes forget my measurements because I just throw things such in.
Yeah.
Just a little bit more nutmeg, half a teaspoon. Half a teaspoon of cinnamon.
Well, a good cook cooks with love, don't they?
Yeah, so and also just throw caution to the wind.
Yeah,
and just not even, that's probably a quarter of a teaspoon, and then another half a teaspoon of that, and we're just going to mix it.
Good.
Add water to it, and then
make a mess. Having a bit of a party in the kitchen here.
Just scrape that away, just pretend we didn't see that.
So it's part of the fun in the kitchen,
isn't
it? It
is a part of the fun. It's okay to be messy, guys.
And she's doing all the work. I'm just here
asking
a few questions.
Exactly. Nisha's just here looking pretty, as usual.
Oh, you're so sweet.
Oh, I know.
Thank you.
So the trick with rice... Oh,
that's sliding.
It is. It's a slip and slide.
Safety.
So the trick with rice, you want it on the first line of your thumb, of your, sorry, index finger.
Okay.
And you just cover that until it reaches that.
Wonderful.
And then you just put the lid on.
Beautiful. So we've got it to that stage, but obviously due to our time, we've got one that was prepared earlier.
Of course, So you just let that boil and then lower the heat.
Okay.
So here is one that we have prepared earlier.
Am I able to taste this
one? Of course. So we just top it with roasted almonds. Mm-hmm. So you just can roast this in the microwave or over on a frying pan. And we just top that. So there you go. Bon appetit.
Lovely. Thank you. So we can have a nice look at that. That looks amazing. And I'm going to try some.
Please do. Let me know what you think. So the crunch of the almonds really just gives a really nice texture to the rice.
I put a lot in my mouth.
You sure did. You must be hungry, Nisha.
Amazing, so beautiful.
Oh, thank
you. Great texture, and I love the crunchiness of the nuts. Perfect. Sandra decided me to be rude talking food in my mouth. Thank you so much for coming on to Fresh and Local.
It's lovely to be back again.
Where can we find out more?
Sure, so you can go on www.meese.com.au.
So if you have an event coming up, whether it's a birthday, whether it's an engagement party, over the Christmas period, I think get in contact with Sandra because you can not only have her there, but you can actually teach people how to cook as well.
Exactly.
Beautiful. Well, we'll see you very soon, hopefully, before the end of the year.
I hope so too.
Okay. So if you missed any of that, of course, you can go to thecouch.com.au or our Facebook page. But for now, it's back to you, Fred.
That is it for the show today. Thank you, Nisha. Thank you to Sandra. Don't forget meast.com.au. We'll see you next week. Take care all around Australia. Hope the coronavirus has less impact on all of us next week. Keep smiling. Bye for now. See you then. On the couch with us.